start with, I think one major thing is in weaving itself, women don't have space at all. Like I would tell, this is the first time when we went to actually form women collectives in East Godavari. They say women can't design. Okay, so from manual works to, if you say the creative works, women have been systematically marginalized. So for example, any creative works or technical works, the common refrain has been women can't do this, women can't do that. But in reality is they have never been provided space. So that is at a household level. So even like we used to go and discuss about basically new product, new designs, they say that we can't take the decision. Men in the household have to take the decision because technically loom belongs to them. So from then to now, the journey has been really great. And so no longer permissions are needed for any kind of production decisions. So then if we move at the collective level, the major gap at collective level has been women have never been part of any of the primary weaver cooperative societies, which have been started 1950s, 40s and 60s, it has proliferated. So women have never been the members of any of these collectives. So they are completely absent from the economic space at all, at the household level. Even though 50% of the work has been done by women from BCs and ADs, so from the time the clothing has, we have been weaving. So I think that has been the major second gap where they are not part of the any of the collectives. So no space, no ecosystem is a major gap that we have been working on and fighting since long. And unfortunately, like when we work also, when we support and promote these collectives, the employees who are part of these collectives are also mostly men. It's very difficult to get women who are skilled. So we cannot lament that we are not getting skilled women because that ecosystem has never been there. Do we get women accountant? Do we really get women who can understand production? So basically, as I say, again, the same, the ecosystem problem comes. So unfortunately, even the people who help support all these enterprises to run also are men, because there's so much dearth of skilled women that you, so because where there is a knowledge, the power rests there. So for us to really work, the gap is the knowledge has been systematically taken away from women. So at an individual household level, at the collective level, no membership, and even the new collectives that we are creating where women are members, the steering is done by men. It's been really unfortunate. So no space, no ecosystem. And secondly, when we start these collectives, basically, I think we don't trust women. We don't trust their potential, and we start with very narrow vision because working across the entire integrated value chain is so overwhelming. So from the time when I was 24, taking these proposals to do something for women, we go to different funders, ask for money and say, what are the solutions? So they basically, I have been hearing the common refrain that weaver women production karne hai na karne do. Let them do production. You people are educated and say from cities, why don't you handle marketing? Basically the cream. So we don't come from that kind of school of thought. So Dr. Kurian always said the cream has to be with the women. The marketing has to be with the producers. So basically I faced in the initial 3-4 years, a lot of issue in convincing that women can handle value chain. So basically the way we conceptualize collectives, there's a huge gap where they say entire value chain from the yarn to the end market, women can't handle. So this has been the common refrain. So as a person who is privileged and say born in a city and have done MBA, I took 7 years to learn marketing. So leave off the education where you actually don't learn marketing. So women will learn in 14 years. So since I'm educated, I'm learning in 7 years, maybe I understand a little bit and maybe I can go out in the market. So there has been this constant undermining of the potential that women can handle the entire value chain. So the major gap which comes with this is conceptualization of the collective itself is very narrow. No processing, no infrastructure. So basically they do something, do a little bit of value add and sell. So you end up with a very suboptimal solution, suboptimal products, and completely compromised value chain, which actually adds on to the cost of the product. So not believing in the potential that women can do business and handle the value chain has been the second most important gap. And the third and the last thing, which is very crucial also, to understand collectives are economic private enterprises of women. group of women or men or the producers. They are not public institution nor the welfare institutions. So most of the time, it's very difficult to fight off, and especially Telangana, which has been the pioneer, Andhra at that time, the combined Andhra is a pioneering state which enacted Mutually Aided Cooperative Societies Act, where because of support of N.T. Rama Rao, where actually collectives, cooperatives are seen as economic enterprises, private enterprises owned by a group of people, and the objective is economic. So many of the times what happens, the way collectives are also conceptualized, their economic objective and agenda is sometimes compromised. And it's a private enterprise. So sometimes even that is also compromised. So I think to sum up the three main gaps, there is no ecosystem to recognize skilled women. So you end up women being wage laborers, and actually the main steering is done by men. So that's one. And the second gap is underestimating the potential of women. And this in turn makes us devise collectives which are suboptimal. And the third one is not recognizing collectives as economic private enterprises of group of producers. And we work with 700 women. So from the starting itself, as I said, we initially at 24, we had this notion. I mean, it might sound not politically correct, but making professionals out of weavers, creating professionals, they should be able to handle the market. These kind of ideas we had, and I don't think there is any change in the way that we have thought or think. Maybe we were able to identify the gaps much better and have a more nuanced approach to things. But from the day one, I think we worked on the skills of the weavers. So more importantly, not that there is a gap, I mean, it is an artificial gap that has been systematically created. So we felt initially, we thought techno-managerial skills is a term we often used to use. And like we have never ever in any of our training programs thought that will the weavers be able to do? Like personally, I'm really hard on myself and the team to push ourselves to some level. And we have been the same with all the women we have worked. So to give an example, the first training program that we did, but initially at that time, since it was difficult to mobilize women and I didn't have the understanding patients, a lot of fear have to how to really. So we did program with actually men and youth, and few of them are already the employees of the producer enterprises and Chitrika. We designed a program for 5 days, and we did something like strategic planning, business planning, sensitivity analysis and all. We finished the program in 3 days. That's a level of skill in terms of understanding the numbers, understanding a lot of which weavers have. Basically, they're very good at numbers. So from there, we started. And the recently, after the Swashakt project started, we were thinking, we actually have developed a strategic note on skilling in general, and specifically also for women, like what we should skill in, what basically. So there are two things which emerge. There's loss of sense of pride in what they are doing, actually. Like many of our staff members, men are not getting married because they have weavers and they have looms. Women, because many of them don't want to get in where there is a loom, because there's a lot of work, and that work is also not respected. And it is like a 24-hour work. It's not like you start at 10 and close at 6. So there's a lot of loss of sense of pride in what they were doing. And second, most importantly, and also one of the government officials gave an example long back. This is also another starting this. Weavers are like tigers. They have a lot. So they are becoming extinct because they are not able to adapt to the changing environment and situation. But it's so true for individuals and also say an MBA professionals to weavers. Agility and adaptability, and in this definitely fast changing world, is what also they were missing out. So how do we bring a sense of pride back into them through skilling? And two, through skilling, how do we teach them a sense of agility and adaptability is what emerged as two key areas in skilling. And at a more operational level, through this program, how do we create 100 leaders who will take this value, this agenda forward, so that it percolates down to and amplifies to many number of different weavers? So the idea is to create such kind of leaders at a philosophical level, the vision, And at the operational level, what a value chain and what a business requires is what we zeroed in on to. So basically, this is a 9-month program. It's a higher education program for women who in a formal setup who don't have access to this kind of a program. So it has roughly 2 to 2.5 months of classroom training, which might happen in a city or which might happen in the local area where they are. And a 6-month practicum where they will be practicing what they have learned, what they have want to learn by being part of the collective that they are in, and or they become potential members. So basically, the idea is to, through this 9-month program, they are going to amplify and bring in more women and create an ecosystem for women. And skilling is only one of the medium. And the skilling will also add to what we are creating through 3i's support, integrated handloom hubs. Actually, many of the government schemes, actually, if you read what the schemes are, they're actually wonderfully designed. It's another thing that unit economics do not work out, that the money is too low. Like we want to do an MBA, we need at least 15 lakhs minimum even to get into a top-notch institutes, so which are government-aided. So, what has happened is unit economics don't work out, but they are wonderfully designed schemes. They have all the components. You have YAM Bank, you have dying unit, you have market, you have everything. So basically, through this integrated handloom hub, where predominantly we are aiming, hopefully we are successful, to create safe space for also to women to work on design, to work women on dyeing. So they work on the pre-loom. So this integrated handloom hubs, which will provide, which is a space end-to-end, and it also has marketing component. So how do we create spaces in these kind of handloom hubs where it is viable, create safe place for women? That will also be a space for amplification of the skilling program and also a lot of skilling, women to men, men to women, and women to the external world. How this skilling is going to happen is also an important experiment. So this handmade MBA will also be deepening our own understanding of how to create this viable handloom hubs where they are self-sufficient, local is the thing. So basically, the gap that we identify is basically how they have been systematically not been part of the ecosystem, the skilling will exactly do. So it has hard components like learning the design, say, or learning how to do dyeing, or understanding how to create a garment. Two, it has communication skills, leadership. It has a self-transformation component where we'll be working on the individual. So where they can actually bargain and create a space for themselves at the household level, to at the collective level, to the outer world, in the three spaces. So we have all the softer components and also the modern day business components, understanding things through case study, how to manage the HR, how to manage the enterprise, how to be good board members, and how to create a safer space for women to be part of this collective. So it has both the so-called the heart component and the leadership and the business components. So that's what this handmade MBA is about. One more point which is just wanted to add is, yes, many of the times I understand we are producing for the urban customers. That's how sadly it has become. But when handloom was the mainstream clothing, when from a young to old, when from all occasions handloom was used, it was vibrant. So the time we slotted into a luxury product and for the urban market, it is slowly dying and it will die. So through the skilling also, we want to work on the brand, more of which I'll cover in the third component. But basically what I want to say is we are trying to create a producer to consumer model, and basically prosumer, producer to consumer, where it is very important for me personally also, which has been a starting point of my journey and my team, is to create clothing what weavers can wear. So most of the time weavers are not able to wear what they are producing. So it's very, very important that it's not just for the urban market, not just for the brand. You should be able to wear what you are weaving. So it's also, it requires some kind of technical changes at all, but not just that, increasing the economic, their own economic status to purchase what they are weaving. So it's extremely important we create that product segment. So that's also one of the reasons we deliberately chosen not to work in a lot of luxury garments or the luxury segments. So most of our weavers are like beyond 10th rankers. They're not in the top 10 rankers. So it's a conscious decision to work with people who are medium skill to produce for the affordable clothing brand. Basically, like all these years, I think we want to do an advocacy where a change comes, like producing some articles and not bringing policy change has been a no-go for us. So initially we used to do certain workshop and we are still clear of all the workshops in the last 15 years. I mean, it has to add some value. So beyond that, what? So, but I feel that I first want to create like the evidences of how, like without creating the entire integrated value chain and a marketing brand that is omnichannel, owned by the thing, owned by the producers. So I don't think we have reached to a level where we can actually advocate, but there are definitely certain issues which bother us at a policy level, which why the poor have to be taxed, and specifically the craft persons and weavers have to be taxed, is an important area where many of the peers in other organizations and NGOs have been working on. So we were not able to do much, and it went on, 5% has become 12% now. So definitely the taxation area is one. And also many of the Geographical Indication Act to the reservation is not implemented. So I personally feel we always have to really fight out the unfair and uneven market by good design, market access, and doing a good business model. But it definitely affects the business when it is unfair, from the biggest of brands to designers to a small master weaver. So it has always been non-handloom pitted against the handloom, and a wrong representation that happens. And when what is rightfully theirs and there is an act and it has to be actually implemented, even something like handloom mark actually doesn't work at the ground level. So definitely to make the market and to make it a level playing field, whatever the acts have been implemented, I think the effective implementation where, I don't think much work has happened. And as a ground level organization at grassroots also, we have not cohesively, systematically worked on it. Like you have FICCIs and CIs which actually lobby for the industries and for their thing. So I don't think from our side also, a cohesive body is there to systematically work, because not everybody comes with the bad intention of say ruining anything and pass a scheme, but definitely it requires a lot of eye opening, because we have to become the eyes of the policy maker sometime. So systematic evidence gathering, and in terms of number crunching and how it affects the business, lot of thing has actually also not happened to put it across at the advocacy level. So I mean, emotional tenure is good, but beyond that, what we need, the evidence, we need the numbers, so how to actually make it work at the policy level. So for sustaining all these brands, actually, unfortunately, it takes a lot of effort, because most of the time, even with educated people, negotiating with the market and the market players is a very difficult task. So we ourselves actually undergo a lot of trouble in negotiating and working out with the brands. So I think the links sustain, but the deal is whatever through skilling, in whatever way. How do we bring in women to the negotiating table with the main market player is important, because something like their own contracts are not in, say, the local language. It's in English, and legal language is very complicated even for educated people to understand. So overall, for these to sustain it, apart from the product pricing and all of it, there's an art of just dealing with the market, which is dynamic and which is unfair in terms of even not having local language contracts. I mean, it's difficult. And unfair conditions. So all of it, it's not easy to sustain. It requires a lot of support. So that's the biggest challenge and fear after 10 years. So they should be able to sustain. I think we'll see how it goes. And other thing is that the customer awareness and all is fine, but sometimes customers also have to be brought down to the mother earth, because all the Amazons and Ubers have given them a lot of choices, and generally they don't understand what takes women to come to even to this space overall. So I'm not saying be satisfied with a shoddy service or a product, but expecting something which is not reasonable, and expecting homogeneous products in terms of what a handloom, handicraft and handloom is. So awareness is one part, but at a very philosophic level, they have to be very sensitive to what's the background, where these products come from, and they should pay for what they are liking, and the product is good and functional and not as a charity. So a lot of customer education have to just happen, not around just giving them information. So a lot of attitude change in being sensitive to how this value chain has been built is very important to mind. So it is always very beautiful if you imagine that instead just move off the owners from that scene and we put women collectives in that scene. So creating really modern, rooted in traditional, and giving good experience to the buyer as well as the producer. So we create an omni-channel brand, which is very forward-looking, but staying true to the commitment of the producers and completely managed, not as a lip service. So managing that kind of an omni-channel, I think that's a kind of example which is lacking. Either you have very private exploitative models, or you have something like suboptimal products which actually cannot be there in the market, which requires a lot of changes. So finding and building a brand that works for everyone in the value chain, for the producer, for the consumers, and the vendors in between, and which is more forward looking, that's one. And the second is like a small producer company, which even 300-400 members will require at least 3 to 4 crores investment if they have to have their own dyeing unit and the value addition unit. And if you're going to add the retail chain offline and online, so it requires at least a 10 crore kind of an investment. So it's very important, that's going to be an important lever if you want to bring transformational change in the incomes, so that they're not wage laborers. So how do we increase income from 6 to 10 to 20? It's not going to increase by giving good designs or selling in somewhere in Delhi. It's not going to increase. They have to control the value chain. They have to own the value chain. So it's very important we build a very interesting hybrid also kind of an ownership event. Vendors can also become members, because a dyer is also from the weaving community. So women is also from that community. So it's important that that kind of investments goes in to get a transformational change in the income. Otherwise, they will remain suboptimal.